doesn't it only bring suffering?
Shouldn't we forget about activism? Doesn't it only bring suffering? Asks Hilsa. Mr. Mayor, will you?
There's a huge difference between patriotism and nationalism. Patriotism makes a country stronger. Patriotism makes a country develop. Nationalism might be bringing suffering to a country, and nationalism might make a country weaker. So I'm for patriotism, and I'm strong against nationalism.
You're strong against nationalism wherever it occurs.
Absolutely.
Because there's an awful lot of it around the world, and not least in Europe.
I know.
Okay, we'll pick some of this up, I'm sure.
In 2 years, Latvia celebrates its 100th anniversary, and the reason this country was created was to protect our language, our culture, and this unique place on the planet. So for me, patriotism means protecting these values, but it doesn't mean feeling superior to others or excluding others. So it's being part of a global community, but trying to protect what's unique to our people and to our culture.
And is that consistent with nationalism, a belief in your nation state, alongside or in some cases over and above your feeling for patriotism?
I think in this day and age, a nation state still exists, and we may not see that in 100 years, but I think now there's nothing wrong with nationalism as long as it isn't accompanied by a feeling of superiority, a feeling that your nationalism is better than others. It's a way of promoting diversity in the world. But I think we each have to, just as we want to protect our own individual identity and uniqueness, I think we have to preserve that. And the world spends a lot of time preserving endangered species. I think cultures and languages are also endangered species. And it's our job to keep the world interesting.
Of course, in this part of Europe, as in other parts of Europe, nationalism is a rising force. Nationalism is power. Is that something that disturbs you? The man, Nils, says he strongly opposes that. Do you recognize it as a facet that is inevitable?
I think when nationalism turns into xenophobia, when it becomes racism or anti-Semitism, and then I think it becomes dangerous when it's a threatening emotion or passion. But when it's a healthy one that promotes the good things, it also recognizes the equality of others, and I think there's something wrong with it.
Give me an example of healthy nationalism.
In Latvia, we're a great lover of song. We're a land that sings. We have song festivals. We get 30,000 people in an arena on stage and sing together. That's nationalism, but it's a positive, uplifting nationalism.
I do request.
We think it's very important for ourselves and certainly the listeners of this radio show to understand what we mean by patriotism, nationalism, or for that matter, internationalism. This part of the world tends to be relatively allergic to the word nationalism and would prefer internationalism. There are other parts of the world that see this in the opposite way. I think patriotism and nationalism, by the heart that Martin Oinas just said, is really an allegiance to a culture, a set of values, a language, and a people that you have a certain love for. If you don't love it, you probably won't be patriotic. There's something more highly unlikely to be patriotic. The problem is that the word nationalism these days brings about very negative feelings that are based on, of course, the consequences of World War II in particular. And where the word nationalism, which also includes feelings of pride, are looked upon as a negative entity. Of course, any of these definitions, I would say, are negative if they lead to violence, if they lead to exclusion, if they lead to racism, if they lead to a lack of tolerance. We see the rise of a certain kind of nationalism in France. We see it, of course, also in Germany. We see it, to some extent, here in Latvia. So it's difficult. And I think there needs to be more positive love given.
And when you see it in your own country, yes, in Latvia, where it is powerful, there are those in this country who, if I'm right, who very nearly identify a love of culture, pride in placing identity here with a feeling that foreigners are not welcome. Is that the nationalism, and that can, in many countries in Europe, can slip over into what you describe as xenophobia and racism? Do you detect that in your own country?
Well, I would detect it, first of all, anywhere in Europe, to begin with. I am a Latvian, I was born in Canada. Most of Central Europe, and partially also the Scandinavian countries even, have a distanced view towards any foreigners. Nice, white, black, unpleasant, you know, employable or not employable, it is the state of the nation. Yes, one does discover elements of racism and xenophobia here, but you will discover them in many other parts of the world, in Europe, or at least Europe for sure, these days.
You specialize in international affairs, Magnus Michelsen. What's your take on activism?
Well, it's the kind of question that we would also get in Stockholm, because in Stockholm, patriotism is not being discussed, it's a big no. But I believe that patriotism is a very productive force. It's impossible to understand Latvia's history without so regardless of whether we like it or not, it's been a very productive force. I regard patriotism as a warm fireplace. We can gather around it, we can huddle together, of course everyone is welcome, but it is basically an opportunity to be warm together.
You will know. Those people should know that a famous British writer, man of letters, Samuel Johnson, coined the phrase, patriotism is the last refuge of the scoundrels.
Well, you can do that as well, but that was your question regarding are there any examples of productive patriotism? I would say for Fassos patriotism, what do you do in a country where nationalism is basically forbidden by law? Well, of course, you have to create, it depends on what you create this fireplace of. So if you create this fireplace of democracy, the rule of law, minority rights, etc., of course it can be a very productive force and a very uplifting force.
Okay, yes.
When Sweden plays Finland in ice hockey, isn't there a sense of patriotism at that moment during that game?
Well, of course it is, but in a modern society, it is, of course, very difficult to gather people around this fireplace. So most of the time, it is more of an illusion of patriotism. It is almost a kitsch reproduction of patriotism.
Well, move on from that to our next question. I'm sure some of these things are going to surface again in different forms as we go on. Alexander Sumbar.
Thank you very much.
Ну, очень коротко. Почему вы согласились принять участие в этой дискуссии? Чего вы ожидали? И что, собственно, получилось?
Несмотря на, скажем, теперь уже разнообразный опыт BBC в Латвии, учитывая все последние фильмы, отказать BBC, наверное, это было бы неправильно. Но BBC это еще с советских застойных времен, это как бы, BBC, поэтому как же не прийти?
Чего вы ожидали от этой дискуссии, что в итоге получилось? Вы не разочарованы?
Примерно это и ожидал. То есть, с одной стороны, дискуссия со стороны зала, каждый со своей точки зрения, с другой стороны, ведущие, которые хорошо разбираются в ситуации в Латвии, но все равно не являются абсолютными экспертами. Надеюсь, что слушателям, в данном случае это радиопередача многомиллионным слушателям от Африки до Америки, включая Европу, будет интересно узнать, что у нас здесь происходит.
На ваш взгляд, получилась ли она дискуссия, в смысле всесторонней, всеобъемлющей, более или менее объективной?
Ни одна дискуссия, которая ограничена по времени, часом в стране, о которой 90% аудитории знает очень мало, не может быть ни всеобъемлющей, ни объективной, ни захватывающей все темы. Это только небольшой срез, 0,1% от того, что здесь происходит, но хорошо, что она была.
Услышит ли, на ваш взгляд, эта аудитория то, что лично вам хотелось бы, чтобы она слышала Латвию?
Это, понимаете, это сложный вопрос. как мэру города, мне очень важно, чтобы во всем мире слышали о том, что у нас здесь все абсолютно спокойно, стабильно, все развивается, растет, чтобы люди приезжали сюда как туристы, чтобы инвесторы вкладывали сюда деньги. И в таком контексте, конечно, дискуссия с точки зрения безопасности, небезопасности, захватит ли нас Россия, не захватит, она, ну, делу не помогает. С другой стороны, естественно, как общественный деятель, как политик, я не могу сидеть и рассказывать из серии «Приезжайте к нам в Одессу». Ну, как есть, так есть. Поэтому у меня к таким международным передачам всегда неоднозначное отношение, потому что я должен рекламировать, чтобы все получалось, а с другой стороны, но при этом не особенно удаляясь от правды.
Спасибо.
Спасибо большое.
So maybe first, why did you choose Latvia for these debates?
Why did we select Latvia? Because it's in a very key position inside the European Union, on the borders of Russia. The Baltic states matter. They've got an extraordinary history, and we know there are all sorts of challenges and difficulties that Latvia faces, which is what we were trying to get to in the programme for a large audience listening around the world. No one knows how many. I mean, it reaches over 50 million. Whether every single person is every single part of the programme, of course, is another matter. So it matters to hear what people are saying about the country in which they live.
What do you think if your audience knows much about Latvia?
I think that the knowledge of Latvia around the world is probably very limited. It is bound to be. How many countries are there in the world? 190, 200 countries. Not everyone can know everything about all of them. So I think it's quite limited knowledge. And that's part of the reason why we do it. Because we've been doing four programs centered in Europe, these first four. We've been in Brussels, we've been in Athens, we're here, and then we're going to go to Berlin next. So we wanted to take different parts of the European Union, because the European Union is a huge organization. It's a very powerful economic bloc, and the debates that go on within the individual countries are big questions about the future of the European Union, and that has a big impact on everything that happens everywhere else in the world.
Are you happy with these debates?
Yes, I'm right in the middle of it, so it's very difficult for me to say I'm happy with it. Did I enjoy it? Did I think people were interesting? Did they have pertinent comments? Yes, and I particularly liked it when the audience came in and said things very strongly and openly, because part of what we're doing, you know, Latvia is very democratic in this respect. It's got a very free media, very open, it can say what it likes. But part of this benefit of this is that other countries, which maybe don't have the same degree of openness, can see how people can participate in debate, can say what they think without anything happening to them.
Thank you.
Pleasure.